I want to welcome everybody to our presentation today, Fishkill, Military Supply Hub of the Revolutionary War. My name is Lance Ashworth. I'm president of the Friends of the Fishkill Supply Depot, the host for today's event. I see a lot of familiar faces, which is great, and I also see some new faces. And the more people that we can reach about the Fishkill Supply Depot and its historical importance and its national significance is great. So thank you for coming. I appreciate the presence of folks that I would consider to be our stakeholders. Senator Susarino's office is represented today, Assemblyman Laller's in the back, the town supervisor's office, town planning board members. I sincerely appreciate them taking time out of their busy schedules to come today and hear what we have to say. Today is really an important day, not only for our group, but I think for this town and the Hudson Valley, and dare I say even the nation, because it marks the culmination of nearly 2 years of work on a project to better understand the context of the Fishkill Supply Depot site, both from an archaeological and a historical standpoint. The project began in early 2014 as an idea on our group's board, and it led to our application to the National Park Service for an American Battlefield Protection Program Preservation Grant. Okay, and if you'll permit me, I want to just give you a little bit of background about how we ended up winning the grant, what the grant means, and the significance it holds for the future in terms of the preservation project. The American Battlefield Protection Program was largely set up in the wake of the big battle for the Civil War, the preservation of Civil War battle sites in the South in the mid-1990s. I think most of you remember the big fight that took place in Virginia between Walmart and I believe the Manassas Battlefield. Well, born out of that effort to preserve that site was the Battlefield Protection Program, which is housed in the National Park Service. And from its inception, it had two funding streams. One funding stream relates to acquisition. So those are money set aside by the federal government that groups who are trying to preserve sites can seek in order to purchase land. Okay, so the outright purchase of land. The other funding stream is what they call for preservation, and that's for projects that are battlefield sites that are significant to the nation, significant importance, and ones which not necessarily can be purchased but can be studied and interpreted and better researched in order to understand whether they would qualify for the acquisition side. It's important to note that at the time that we applied for what was then a preservation grant, acquisition funding was not open to Revolutionary War or War of 1812 sites. The Battlefield Protection Program was amended in this last Congress so that battle sites of nearly all wars can now be saved with acquisition funding. So we're excited at that opportunity. So in early 2014, our group wrote a grant application for preservation funding for approximately $25,000. And the intent of the application that we set forth was to bring a professional vendor forward who would be able to identify, locate, gather, or obtain, and then summarize the collective results of any of the past archaeological examinations that had been done in Fishkill. Okay? And at the time, we thought that there were about a dozen of these studies out there. You know, the Fishkill Historical Society, which has really been the anchor here in Fishkill in terms of preserving its history, was home to a number of these studies. But as in preparation for the grant application and later once the grant was won, our research uncovered nearly three dozen separate studies relating just to Fishkill. I think that alone speaks to just how important of a site this is. So after we applied for the grant and won in the summer of 2014, in August of 2014, work began in earnest for our group. A couple of us traveled to Washington, D.C. on official government orders and participated in training, two-day training at the National Park Service, the American Battlefield Protection Program, okay? And the training related to the management of essentially what became a federal contract. So in addition to my full-time job and my role as president of the Friends Group, since the winning of the grant, I've essentially been a government contract manager overseeing the spending of federal funds on this project. And that's what the training related to. So that milestone was achieved in August of 2014. And then, as with any government contract, it was put out to bid. So we developed a scope of work, an intended work plan, a request, request for proposals, and put it out to bid. Initially, we had five vendors come forward, and I'm pleased to introduce in a little bit Hunter Research Incorporated of Trenton, New Jersey, which was ultimately awarded the contract to perform the work in relation to this grant, okay? And so, after some preliminary over-the-phone teleconferences in January and February of 2015, the real yeoman's work, the work on the part of Hunter Research, began. And that's occurred all throughout this year. We've had to have a couple of deadline extensions because the amount of material, especially archaeological related material on Fishkill that is out there, far surpassed what our initial research in the lead up to the grant uncovered, as well as what was uncovered by Hunter along the way. So we've had to essentially extend the deadline for the grant in order to get it completed. We had hoped by today to have presentation booklets and copies of maps that everybody could walk away with, but because of the nature of the deadline getting pushed out into the future, we weren't able to do that. At some point, all those products will become available, okay? But it'll be available only after the review of the National Park Service. There are really two things that I'm hoping that everybody walks away from today's presentation with. The first of which is that the Fishkill Supply Depot, okay, so the revolutionary, the military base that was here during the revolution was much, much larger than we think of it today. I think many of you are aware that it's listed on the National Register of Historic Places. One of the maps in the back depicts the outline or the footprint for the National Register, but it's really, that's just a man-made attempt to try to define the supply depot. In fact, it kind of, it's plain to see that it notches out the Dutchess Mall site. Clearly, at the time of the Revolution, that beautiful, flat, fertile land at the base of the mountain was part of the military site. It wasn't until May of this year when the Battlefield Protection Program's military historian, Pat Jennings, made a trip to Fishkill and walked the ground with our group and with Hunter, that collectively we realized that the Fishkill Supply Depot complex stretches well into East Fishkill, all through Beacon, down to Fishkill Landing, and hugs the Hudson River. And as proof of that, the military historian Pat Jennings pointed out that you have the headquarters for, let's say, General von Steuben, Mount Gulian, which is close to the river, and you have the John Brinkerhoff house that's in the Lomola subdivision, I think is in East Fishkill. And at the time of the revolution, no good army would have ever let flag officers or general officers take residence outside the secure perimeter. So both of those houses would have fallen in to what was then the military perimeter of the Fishkill Supply Depot site. So take a good look at the maps in the back, because Hunter Research, I think, did a fabulous job trying to to redefine what the Fishkill site is. And I'm hoping, again, that you walk away today with that redefinition in mind. The other thing I want everyone to walk away with is that our group does not have a single vision. We don't have a single desire on a piece of property in this area in terms of acquisition, meaning we're not looking to unilaterally acquire any property and preserve it for the future. We want to do it in tandem with the community. We want to do it with partnerships. Our group may be, as they say, leading the charge, but that's only in order to gather the attention of those groups out there that are better funded and have better resources that could help us or enable us to acquire different properties. And then once they're acquired, we want to again engage the community. Of course, our partner, the Fishkill Historical Society, but other groups to better understand the significance of the Fishkill Supply Depot site. I want to reassure everybody that if we are able to obtain any property, we're not the kind of group that's just simply going to slap a hurricane fence around it and let people look at it from the street. Okay. I would offer this as kind of an example of what our group would do if we were able to acquire property. Go to the internet and research the Jamestown Project in Jamestown, Virginia. Okay, it's, of course, you know from history class, the site of the first permanent English settlement in North America. But over the past 15 or so years, there's essentially been a rediscovery project where the original footprint of the Jamestown colony was rediscovered, and then the public was engaged to come in and help learn more about the site, to interpret the site, to participate in its preservation and its study, and it's been an absolute boon to that part of Virginia. And that's the kind of thing that we want to do here. We really think that Fishkill has a potential of being along the lines of a Gettysburg or a Jamestown or a Williamsburg. With a little creative vision, with your input, with our partnership, we might be able to get it done. So now I know you didn't come here to listen to me speak, so I'm going to introduce Dr. Richard Hunter of Hunter Research Incorporated. Again, our group couldn't have been more pleased, honestly, Richard, with the outcome. You basically validated all of what we felt heading in terms of what the hope for project was. And so I thank you for that, and I appreciate you coming today.
So I'm Richard Hunter. It's nice to see so many people here. And thank you, Lance, for the introduction there. So what we'd like to do this afternoon, this is myself and Jim Lee from our firm in Trenton, is give you an overview of this 9-month study that aimed to synthesize the history and archaeology of the Fishkill Supply Depot, and offer some suggestions, very much from the standpoint of historic preservation, as to how best to protect and promote the truly extraordinary Revolutionary War history that you have here in Fishkill. Disclaimer, we are very conscious that we are out-of-towners, usurpers of your heritage. Especially me with my plummy English accent. So what we're going to offer you today, it may be a little light on specifics. It's deliberately pitched as an overview of what is a really immense and complicated topic. Many of you here in the audience will have a far superior detailed knowledge of Fishkill's history and archaeology than we ourselves do. And I think this is inevitable in these kinds of projects when you hire somebody from outside to come in. So There may be a few misstatements of historical and archaeological fact on which we are more than willing to stand and be corrected. Not too many of them, we hope, but there might be. So as the brochure shows here, we've organized this presentation into three separate segments. I'm going to talk for a half hour or so on Fishkill's Revolutionary War history. My colleague Jim Lee will then, after a break, will do the same on the archaeology. We'll each of us speak for 30, 40 minutes. And then the pair of us, restrained and I hope enhanced by Lance, will tread warily for just a few minutes on the topics of modern day historic resource management and historic interpretive opportunity. So here goes with the historical synthesis. That's my piece of it. I plan to progress smartly through the following subjects: the Fishkill location and our area of study. I'll say a few words on the historical sources. I'll hit just a few of the high spots in the timeline of Fishkill's wartime history. From there, I'll go on to a little bit more focused of a look onto the into the historic maps, which I think you'll find pretty interesting. I'll say a little about some of the people, the officers and the artificers. A few words on the types of activities that were going on here at the depot and in the surrounding area. And then finally, as a lead-in to the archaeology, with the help of a few later maps and aerial photographs, we'll look very briefly at the land use history of the depot site from the late 18th century down to the present day. So to start with one historical fundamental, the Fishkill area played an immensely important role in the success of the American military throughout the Revolutionary War from the fall of 1776 up until the winter of 1782-83, by which time the British, bless them, had pretty much thrown in the towel. Fishkill was the key military supply facility in the Hudson Highlands, supporting the operations not only of the Northern Department of the Continental Army, but also of the New York Militia, and to some extent the militia of the neighboring states of Connecticut and New Jersey. At the outset of this study, as Lance was indicating, from looking at the maps, from doing some basic reading, and speaking with a lot of people who were more knowledgeable than ourselves, it became very clear that to truly understand what was happening in Fishkill during the Revolution, we needed to cast quite a wide net over the landscape. We're not talking here just about the depot site, as you probably know it, right here on Route 9. This was not going to be a case of homing in on the depot site, concentrating our efforts on that single location of a few hundred acres or so. Fishkill's true historical meaning, so far as the Revolutionary War was concerned, lay in a much broader area, which you see delineated on this map here. The study area that we ended up defining for ourselves, and this, as Lance mentioned, was with some help from Colonel Patrick Jennings from the National Park Service, the military historian with the American Battlefield Protection Program. He helped us apply the tenets of military terrain analysis, tried to get us inside the heads of the American military officers of the time who were making the decisions in the late summer of 1776 about where supply facilities really should be sited. The goal at that time was to contain the British in New York City, number one, and number two, to prevent their advancing up the Hudson Valley, up to Albany, and then connecting up to Canada. Because if the British were able to do this, they would be able to cut off New England from Philadelphia and the middle Atlantic states, and pretty much nip the Revolution in the bud. So American forts were established further downstream on the Hudson from Fishkill. You probably know these sites, Fort Montgomery, there's a cluster of forts at West Point. Fishkill lies just behind, in the lee of the first most southerly range of hills in the Hudson Highlands. It also lies 5 miles or so up Fishkill Creek from the Hudson, out of the range of British warships. The village of Fishkill is at a key crossroads in the landscape in the regional road network, at the intersection of the post road from New York to Albany and the main road heading west from Danbury to the ferry at Fishkill Landing, i.e. the main east-west route that linked New England to New Jersey and Pennsylvania. So our area of study, when we thought about it, should really be the geographic entity that you see here. And it has a dotted line there that you'll see on the map, and then three circular locations, which we're calling the three core locations, within that delineated area. It also includes the surrounding hills and the lower portion of Fishkill Creek. I have to stand off a little here to... Can you hear me if I speak now? Can you hear me all right? Okay, so these three core areas we're talking about, one is the landing on the river, the Fishkill Landing, that's Beacon today. And you see in the top left there a nice roughly contemporary image looking downstream from Fishkill Landing towards Storm King and West Point. A little sign on the bottom right there which marks the importance of the landing. You have on the right here the village itself, which is the core location at the crossroads, the village, and a couple of references to churches there, both of which actually played an important role during the Revolution. The First Reformed Church, which is the old photo in the background, and the marker referencing Trinity Church at the bottom there. That's two of the locations. And then the third location is the depot site, of which the principal remaining feature today is the Van Wyck homestead. Fine building there, which was a base within the depot where officers stayed and where some of the bureaucratic business was conducted. And in the bottom left, you'll see a marker referencing the military cemetery that was located within the depot site, which we'll be talking about a fair bit today. So there we have a larger area with three sort of core locations within it. This shows much the same area but a slightly broader view, and it will place Fishkill in relation to other key military locations. You can see at the bottom of the image there the West Point forts, the chain across the Hudson. And on the far left of that map, you'll see the New Windsor Cantonment. These are two absolutely critical other military locations to which Fishkill was very, very closely tied. You can also see from this map the advantageous topography, and that it shows up pretty well as the brown there. And all these numbered circles on the map there, they indicate locations of markers that are there today and also some of the well-known sites that are within the broader hub, as we're describing it. There's many mills, half a dozen mills, many more farms and houses that also all had strong connections to the supply operations. Just as a couple of examples there, number 21 on the top of the brown here. See if I can... My desk, number 21 here, that's the site of a beacon, the military beacon. So that's within our area. That's a key feature of the hub, being able to see out and downstream as to who might be approaching. Who else do we have? I had number 17 up here, that's Judge Jay's house, and he was a key figure, obviously. During the Revolution, that was where he lived after he moved out of New York City. And each of these numbers are referenced there. I think, believe one of the maps in the back will give you a better sense of that. There's one location on this map, a very important one, Wickapee Pass, which is the point in the range to the south of Fishkill, right in here, where Route 9, the post road, heads up north through that range and into the Fishkill Valley. That is a sort of pinch point in the landscape, a place where any northward advancing troops, British troops, would get funneled into this pass. So it was an important defensive position within the military supply hub for Americans guarding the supply depot. So just to go off on a slight tangent here, there were no major military engagements within this area that we've defined here on the map. No big battles. But there were two important skirmishes that were noted. In March of 1777, as a sort of follow-on from a British attack on Peekskill, the British advanced further north up Route 9, up the Post Road, and there was a skirmish actually at Wickapee Pass. Don't know the precise location, but it's pretty much in the pass area. And then later on in the same year, in mid-October of 1777, this is around the time of the Battle of Saratoga, and the British were probing up the Hudson in potential support of Burgoyne coming down from Canada. And in the course of one British naval expedition up the Hudson, they burned Kingston. And during that, there were a couple of episodes on the Hudson right off of Fishkill Landing where there was exchange of fire between ships and American troops on the shore, also some burning of American ships on the banks of the Hudson as well. So those represent the two sort of main episodes of engagement that would qualify as battles, and I think they're a big part of why the Fishkill Supply Depot friends received their grant. This was the only serious fighting actually around Fishkill. There was an awful lot of sort of nuisance crime going on, though. There were loyalists out in the hills who would come in and raid and destroy things, steal things, and there's a tremendous number of references to that going on in the documents. And there were also several times that the stores at Fishkill, in anticipation of the British attacking up the Hudson, the stores were taken out of the depot and removed into the hills, into the surrounding hills. So now to go on to the documentary material. There's a tremendous amount of primary archival material that relates to Fishkill, that mentions Fishkill in one way or another. We've looked at very, very little of it. We're not military historians, we're primarily archaeologists, but we did try and get a sense of this. And I'd like to actually acknowledge a couple of people. I don't know if they're in the room, since I've never actually met you. Judy Wolfe, are you here? Thank you, Judy. We corresponded by email. And Marty Beister, I don't know if he's here. Okay, thank you both very much. I mean, you've shared information, it's been tremendously helpful. Really appreciate it. So we've sort of dabbled in the history, the historical sources, enough to get a sense of what's out there. And I think that's been a very useful thing to do. As I say, there's a lot of references to Fishkill. Some of them are quite substantive and quite specific. A lot of them are just purely incidental. And it's often difficult to know whether it's actually the village or the depot or the landing that's actually being talked about some of the time. So we ended up looking at this in a couple of ways, the source materials. One was to identify individuals who are known to have been in Fishkill during the war and who do have associated manuscript collections. And this slide just gives you a sense of who some of these people are. So they're a real mixture of people. John Adams, the president. The next guy down, Thomas Anbury. He was a British officer who was captured at Saratoga, passed through Fishkill and wrote about what he thought Fishkill was like at that time. So you got a real mixture of people. You've got Hessians, also prisoners, French visitors, the Marquis de Chasteloup. There's several American officers in here, William Heath, John Stark, John Sullivan, they're all American military officers, George Washington. So these people have manuscript collections in various places around the country that do have material that do talk about Fishkill. So they're all potentially important sources of information. The other way we were looking at this was to approach the archival sources as categories of manuscript materials that might also contain Fishkill data, and especially the records of the military and of governmental bureaucracies. So this next slide here lists some of these categories of primary archival information. Same sorts of things.
It's a wide range of material, but the top one in particular, the War Department records, this is an immense body of material, absolutely masses of material. Just referenced it very generally as Record Group 93 in the National Archives, but there's lots and lots of material there, accounts, reports, letters, all kinds of things that you will find scattered here and there, references to Fishkill, some of them very informative, some of them less so. And then there's a variety of other material listed below that.
So we sort of, as a while processing through these archival materials, you can begin to construct a sort of timeline of events and activity at Fishkill, which we began to do in some detail, and will be available in the report that will eventually come out from this project that you'll get to see. It's far too complex a timeline to show in a PowerPoint slide, but so this is a very, very simplified version, which will also be in the booklet that we're shortly be issuing as well. On the left side, you have the sort of national events of the war, and on the right, you have a succession of things that relate specifically to Fishkill. For example, in the fall of 1776, the provincial government moved out of White Plains and up to Fishkill and met in Fishkill for almost 6 months over the winter of 76 and 77. So that's listed in the timeline there. That is also the time when the depot pretty much gets established, so that you have barrack buildings both at the Wickerby Pass location and just out down the street here in the core of the depot site. There, barracks are in place and probably other buildings, storehouses and such, by the end of 1776. Going on down the timeline, you'll see references to British attacks up the Hudson, some of them causing stores to be relocated outside of the Fishkill area up into the hills. You'll see there's mentions of pay disputes and for the workers in the depot. In spring of 1781, there are plans to discontinue the post, but those are resisted and the Fishkill keeps going for another couple of years or so. And then finally, at the bottom, there's the sort of decommissioning of the post over the course of the winter of 82-83. So that's the beginnings of a timeline. So next, the maps. There's really three types of maps, and I'm talking contemporary maps here. These are maps that were made at the time Fishkill was operating as a military supply base. You have regional maps that show much of the Hudson Valley, actually in many cases much of the northeastern United States. There are a lot of these, just the top two are just a couple of examples. The Montresor map, I think, is the one at the top there from 1775. Most of these maps were created in New York City. A lot of them were printed in Europe, in London and in Paris. They show Fishkill as a location on these maps. It's as part of a much larger landscape. There is, however, one detailed one of the Highlands that was produced by Robert Erskine in 1779. That's towards the bottom of the table there. They're listed chronologically. And that's a particularly informative map of the New Jersey Highlands and Hudson Highlands, either side of the Hudson. Wonderful map. The second category is American military maps, and these were actually formally surveyed cartographic exercises, and these were done by the American military under Robert Erskine, who was the first surveyor general, and then the guy who succeeded him, Simeon DeWitt. And there are four maps that show Fishkill in some detail by Erskine, all done in 1778, and there's one done by DeWitt in 1780. And they are surprisingly uniform in the information that they show in terms of buildings and where they're located. I'll show you one in a moment. So the third category of maps of which there's just two examples, are they're kind of sketch maps, and they were done by the British military during the war, and they were based on spy information for the most part. So they're not properly surveyed maps. They are sketches, literally sketch maps. So I'm just going to show you examples of
one of each of these. So this is the regional map. This is the Montresor map. There's a big blue circle showing roughly where Fishkill is. This is available online at the Library of Congress. You can go and download a wonderful high-resolution copy of this, and you can home in on that. You can see how Fishkill fits into the surrounding landscape. So Albany is obviously up in here, New York City down in here, and you get a sense of really how Fishkill fits into the broader landscape, the military landscape, cultural landscape. So there's a lot of maps like this. They all look very similar, put out by lots of different people. This is the second category. These are these properly surveyed American military maps, principally by Robert Erskine. And these are two of the Erskine maps, both from 1778. You've probably seen, I think, probably the one on the left. This shows the village right up here. The Hyatt is probably about here. And then the Van Wyck homestead is, I believe, that building. Then there's a storehouse here, a couple of barracks here. Come on down Route 9, and there's more barracks down in here. So this is one of four maps that all show pretty much the same buildings. So we can believe them pretty strongly here. This is on the right. And this is a broader area map, not so much a route map as the one on the left is. And this shows the same buildings. It's hard to see, I know, at small scale here on the screen, but it's showing exactly the same set of buildings. And then the final category is these British sketch maps. There's two versions of this map by it's attributed to Patrick Ferguson, who was a British military officer who was killed shortly after this, actually. I think he died in the Carolinas in maybe in 78. But he drew this map, of which this is just a part. It extends from Peekskill up to north of Fishkill. And I've just homed in on the Fishkill area here. And here's the village, the crossroads. You see how schematic this is. These things down in here are buildings not accurately positioned at all, showing you where certain structures are. So that says Van Wyck. That's the Van Wyck house, the homestead. This says barracks and storehouses, I believe. So this clump of four buildings here. And then down in here, you've got, that says barracks said to be burnt. They're interesting little annotations. This is a wonderful annotation up here. This says, Dirk Brinkerhoff, a warm rebel, which is also a state assemblyman. So it's a nice turn of phrase there. Okay, so now I'm going to just a few words on the people who were at Fishkill, and I'm going to work down from the most senior military officers down through the quartermaster generals to the supply officers, and then down to the actual workers, the artificers, as they would call themselves. So here we have upper left George Washington. He was sort of passing through a Fishkill on occasion, and you see references to that in the primary documentation. For example, he was in and out of Fishkill in late September of 1778, during the period when the British were launching attacks up the Hudson from New York City. In the center, you have George Clinton, who in his capacity as governor and head of the New York militia was frequently in the Fishkill area, especially over that winter of 76 through 77, when the government provincial Congress was actually meeting in Fishkill. He would have been here the whole time, pretty much. And then on the bottom right here, you have Henry Knox. He was in Fishkill, for example, for two straight months from March 12th in 77 through mid-May, organizing the artillery supplies at the depot. He took a particular interest in the artificers' pay problems, and you'll see that reflected in the correspondence quite a bit.
And he also actually fought the closure of Fishkill in the spring of 1781. And I think probably largely as a result of him intervening, the posts stayed active for a little longer after that. Sorry. Anyone know who that is? This demonstrates the perils of online research. Google searching, believe me, is so omnipresent these days. We do so much of our research online, and we are always looking for good images of historical figures, so that on many occasions we would go Google George Clinton, and we get this, we just love this picture so much. George Clinton is a rock musician, if you don't know this, Parliament Funkadelic, is that right? Yeah. But anyway, this is a reminder to you all to take the Google monster with a pinch of salt. So the quartermaster generals. These absolutely critical people to the history of Fishkill. One of them is missing, actually, Stephen Moylan, who was briefly quartermaster general in 76 and 77. But you've got the three key people here, Thomas Mifflin, Nathaniel Green, and Timothy Pickering. And all of the quartermaster generals have voluminous records associated with them, especially Green and Pickering, with respect to Fishkill. Green was in Fishkill on several occasions, for example, in mid-May of 78, right after one of his junior officers, Hugh Hughes, resigned as deputy quartermaster general. So you'll see a lot of correspondence between Green and his supply officers at Fishkill, especially this guy Hughes, and also another fellow, Udney Hay. And here we move on to this one. So we get to the point, as you go down the chain of the hierarchy, you kind of run out of portraits. So we have to make do with signatures of people's letters for the bottom there. So we don't have portraits of Hugh Hughes or Udney Hay. We just have their nice handwriting. So in addition to the quartermaster generals, we have these commissary generals of military stores. And there's two of those during the period of the war, Benjamin Flower, who served until 1780, and then followed by Samuel Hodgdon, who was his deputy and then got promoted when Flower died, who served from 1780 onwards. There's not a lot of material that relates to Fishkill with regard to Flower, but Hodgdon has, again, an immense body of documentary material that relates to what was going on in terms of supplies. So his letterbooks, Samuel Hodgdon's letterbooks, contain a trove of information about what was coming in and going out of the Fishkill depot. The officers were frequently submitting returns of what was in the military stores, usually on a monthly basis, and these are the kinds of records that I'm talking about that are held by the War Department. And then we go on down here, and we get to the artificers, the people who were employed here at the depot. There are a lot of different types of workers at Fishkill. The key workers, I think, here's a few of them. Various kinds of smiths, blacksmiths, whitesmiths, tinsmiths, all kinds of smiths, masons, armorers, wheelwrights, carpenters, saddlers, wagon makers, wagon masters, shipwrights. There were a whole load of shipwrights working at Fishkill Landing, both making and repairing ships all through the war. There were people making and repairing tents, clothes, blankets, shoes, all kinds of things that everyday things that the military would need. These workers are visible in the records to some degree. You'll get names of them in returns filed with the Commissary Department, in correspondence between officials, often involving complaints over pay or conditions. In January 1779, the Fishkill Carpenters and Wheelwrights, that's what they call themselves, petitioned Nathaniel Green over pay and poor working conditions. And this was a dispute that went back and forth for several months all through that year, and there's a lot of written material relating to that. just to give you a sense of the kinds of products, I just picked one thing. I for some reason, I get fascinated by tents. So tents is one of the things that they were making, they were repairing, they were storing them, they were shipping them in and out of Fishkill all through the war. And there's lots of different types of tents. You have these common soldiers' tents that you see at the top there. And then this larger image at the bottom is a horseman's tent. So those are tents that you could get horses inside. And what's so great about this is it gives you the specifications for building these things. So in the middle there it says 56 yards of duck. And then it talks about cord and hooks and eyes and twine. All the kinds of things that you need to make tents out of. And so you get great sort of contemporary, original documentation that will throw light on things like this. There are obviously lots and lots of other products that the depot was involved with, various kinds of arms, ordnance, artillery, all sorts of tools, wagons, and forage, collecting forage from the surrounding countryside for the livestock. That was obviously a big, big factor. So the final little piece here, before we move, break for a little bit, is just to look at the what happened to the depot after the war. So the village probably pretty much returned to normal village life after the war was over in the early 1780s. The landing certainly continued and actually became busier, if anything, as a ferry location right after the war. But the depot by 1783 was probably pretty much abandoned and deserted. Don't know this for sure. I think that's an area where research may be helpful. The map on the left is from 1789.
And the circle down at the circle down here shows the depot site. So this is the Maya Cafe would be right where that bend is down there. I-84 would come through right here. There's no buildings at all shown on that map along Route 9. There's other ones shown further north and further if you go further south as well. But it looks like pretty much all the major buildings have gone by the end of the 1780s, if that map is to be believed. Quite possibly the buildings were robbed out for reuse by other local building projects. So most of the land reverted to farmland, and the map on the right, which is from the 1870s, I think sort of reflects that. There's several later 19th century maps. So the depot site is again within the yellow circle. There's, a few houses now showing up along Van Wyck Lake Road here and Snook Road, but there's nothing really in the depot site, which is right in here. There are maps that show horticulture as being an important part of the use of the land in the late 19th century. So they have maps that show you that. So let's just turn to some aerial photos and just quickly go through these, and then we'll pause for a moment. So this is a mid-1930s aerial. It's got superimposed on it Route 84 so that you can get a better sense of where we are. So you can see the ramps and the main highway there. The Van Wyck homestead is that building right there. The Maya Cafe building, which is a historic building, is down in here. So this entire area has pretty much gone back to farmland. A lot of it's cultivated. You can see a lot of sort of telltale marks in the fields over here on the west side of today's Route 9. Some of those may be drainage ditches. Some of them may possibly be a reflection of the depot itself. You can't really be too sure, but there's some curious markings in the aerial there. If we go on another 20 years to 1955, same thing. We've got the highway, still isn't built, but we've put it on top of the drawing, so the aerial, so it makes it a little bit easier to understand. You can see that portions of the site are now reverting to woodland. There's a strip in here. And this area over in here. And the cemetery site would be down in here. So that's the mid-50s. And then 1970, the highway is now built. It's the earliest version of it. We've got a gas station here that was no longer there today, but that's a gas station. We got some homes, late 20th century homes showing up here on the east side of Route 9. There's this clump of buildings over there too. And then we go to 1980, and now we've got Duchess Mall. So this gives you a sense of what's happening to the landscape. So there's a large portion on the west side of Route 9 that has been largely obliterated by the construction of the mall. But the land on the east side of Route 9 is, compared to that, relatively untouched, but reverting back to woodland. So that I think is a okay point to stop for, just pause for a minute, and when we pick up again, how long are we breaking for?
We'll go till 3:30.
Okay. What time are we at? What are we at right now?
3:05.
Okay. So that's a sort of history overview. I mean, it could be a lot more complex than what I've given you, but it's a start. And Jim will talk to you about more specifically the archaeology within the area that you're seeing on that aerial when we start up again. Okay.
To begin part two of today's presentation.
Okay, can everyone hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay, I need a footstool. A little short for this. I'm going to talk about the archaeological investigations that have been conducted at the Fishkill Supply Depot. And as Richard was saying, the depot is much larger than the depot site. But I'm going to concentrate on the Fishkill Supply Depot site that's been defined by its National Register boundaries. And that's in part just to kind of keep the study in check. The larger Fishkill area has had a lot more archaeological studies conducted on them. I'm going to limit mine to the limits of the National Register boundary. Okay, this is a synthesis of the studies that have been conducted, and our research has shown that there's around 50 different instances of archaeology being conducted in this area, and I'm going to go through each one of them in great detail. I'm just kidding. I'm not really. I'm going to go through them in a sort of a summary way, and just show you the overall the sort of potential, the archaeological potential that still exists. First off, I'm going to be talking a lot about the archaeology of the Revolutionary War period and the 18th century. I just wanted to throw this slide up very quickly at the beginning that shows the limits of a lot of prehistoric archaeological sites that is Native American archaeological sites that have been identified in the depot area. Now, these red marks don't mean that there was intense occupation and arrowheads all over the ground, but they mean that these are the location where Native American archaeological artifacts have been found. So I just wanted to kind of get that out of the way. Okay, in the early 20th century, the study of historical archaeology was just sort of coming into fruition. And it's here where we see the first real archaeologists coming up into the area. And that is a group from the New York Historical Society called Field Exploration Committee. And we know from their minutes, from the reports, the annual reports, that they visited Fishkill. We don't know exactly what they did, if they actually dug a site like they did here at the Hempstead Huts. But we know that they were here, they were looking around, they were conscious that there was Revolutionary War period archaeology to be had in this area. Now, for this study, we've separated the Fishkill Supply Depot into four quadrants. That is, with Route 9 being the center. The northeast quadrant is around the Van Wyck House from Snook Road north. The northwest quadrant is a lot of the work that was done for the I-80 interchange. The southwest is the field west of 9, and the southeast quadrant is the field east of 9. And I'm going to roll through the studies that have been done in and around the Van Wyck House. Van Wyck. I'm sorry. The Van Wyck homestead, I should say. Okay. And I have to say that the Van Wyck House area has been one of the most intensely studied of all the areas within the depot site. Specifically, there's been 19 different investigations right on the house property from the 1975 through to the late 80s. These are reported on by Art Carver, and it sounds like he participated and ran a lot of these excavations. He described the results of his excavations in letters and kept a very good detailed plan of the excavations that showed all the different participants. And you can see here, these are color-coded to the various excavations. The house is right in here. And these are all archaeologically excavated test pits that are around the house. These include three different outhouses, a 19th century barn, an ice house. He even dug underneath the kitchen wing and found earlier foundation remains. And a lot of this information, he wrote up letters and sent them off to the New York State Museum. And in the letters, he said that he's working on developing the artifacts, that a lot of the artifacts are at the house. He actually says in one of the letters that he still has some of the artifacts. But I don't think there are actually formal reports of his excavations. There's letters that describe what he did, but there's not what we would call formal plans and profiles of excavation units, catalogs of the artifacts. But despite that, this is still an admirable amount of effort done around the house. There's also some work was done in the driveway of the house when the Route 84 interchange was changed and the driveway was reoriented to Snook Road. 18th century artifacts were found, as you would expect, but no other significant items or features. There's also been some studies done to the east of the Van Wyck House on the town well site, which identified, I think, the 19th century barn associated with the Van Wyck House, and some other studies a little east of those, along just south of 84 and north of Snook Road, that identified a prehistoric site and a 19th century house site. All right. Okay, the northwest quadrant. These studies were largely connected with the construction and the expansion of I-84, which it seems led to a lot of the early interest or the rekindling of interest in the Fishkill Depot site as an archaeological site in the very early late 50s and early 60s. The first study was led by Godfrey Olson, who was under the auspices of the Fishkill Rotary Club. He was able to observe some road widening projects along Route 9, and he observed two foundations. And we have a letter from him that describes what he found, but we don't have any real reports or photos. He described 18th century artifacts in associated with two foundations. One of the foundations had a hearth, and he surmised that these buildings were the remnants of the blacksmith shop, which is shown on the Erskine map. I think this is 1778, and you can see the smith shop. So this circle, this is the Erskine plan. This circle is sort of this quadrant, and this building is labeled Smith shop. Thank you. So he was digging over here, which is we've plotted the building via the historic maps, but his study was just about in this area, and he identified two foundations. There were some additional investigations when the loop was put in by Mark LaRusso, working for the New York State Museum, but he didn't find any other 18th century occupation evidence. And then finally, Paul Huey. When he was asked to come look at the site in 68, he looked at a larger portion of the Fishkill Depot site. He also did some shovel testing, which are test pittings of regular test pits excavated at regular intervals in this area here, but didn't find anything of note. He did produce this plan, and as I mentioned, he excavated in a much broader area than just the northwest quadrant. So this is I-84. This is where the circle is now. This shows his test pitting grid in the old Texaco station, just opposite of Snook Road. He also excavated south of the Rachey Run, right across from Van Wyck Lake Road in our next area. The southwest quadrant. Okay, so you all know this is the location now of the Duchess Mall. These studies sort of start with Paul Huey in the... they don't start with Paul Huey, I'm sorry. They start with Godfrey Olson again for the Fishkill Rotary Club. He conducted some excavation starting in the summer of 62, and I think this is right about the time when the Fishkill Historical Society was formed. And so these excavations also include their help. And in the early 62, and then by 68, Paul Huey comes and he starts, and he documents a lot of the features that they identified in the early 60s. And so this area is, this is Van Wyck Lake Road is here, and the Maya Cafe is here. North is that way. This is Rachey Run. And this is, of course, before the Duchess Mall. And he identified a number of features out in the field. This is a cobble pad. This is a small, shallow trench that's very long. These are rectangular pits. These are refuse pits. And Huey came in 68 and sort of mapped a lot of the stuff that had been excavated in the earlier 60s. And he documented that those finds. And then in 1971, Fishkill Historical Society gets Temple University interested in the site. And now we're looking south, we're looking down the road. This is Route 9. And that's a Maya Cafe for reference. And these are the fields opposite of Van Wyck Lake Road. And these show the study areas from Temple University in 1971 and then 72 and 73. And Temple University becomes interested in the site and they start doing a more formal excavation. Because they understand that the property is going to be developed and a lot of this might be lost. Temple University re-identified several features from the mid-60s excavations, and they also mapped some new features, including the second long parallel trench, and they found more pits out in the out beyond these trenches in the field, and they also interpreted some of the pits that had been found in the 60s as possible latrines and refuse disposal features. And of particular interest to Temple University were some of the pit features that were out in the field that seemed to have 18th century material in them, and then animal bones, and then clean layers of fill on top of them, as if they were refuse pits that were left open to the air that someone came along and quick covered over with dirt, because people were living in this area and they didn't want the noxious smells. But Temple didn't think that they found evidence of the barracks. Now, if we go back to the Erskine plan, which shows two lines of barracks. Now, these might be multiple small buildings or two large buildings, right at the turn of the highway, which would be right in here. Now Route 9 has been realigned. It used to go like that and over. And Temple didn't find what they thought was evidence of the barracks in this area. They offered that this area was probably more of a staging area with small huts and places for people to gather before they were deployed. But they were looking for a substantial foundation or the robbed out foundations of really big barracks that are described in one or two of the sources. And while it's been a long time since they did their excavation. I think you could make some other interpretations about what they were finding, given their methods. They may have been scraping a little bit away, a little bit too aggressively away from the plow zone, and they may have obscured some of the features that weren't as big as they thought they would be. Okay. Let's move over to the southeast quadrant of the site. When Temple University completed its excavations in 71 in the field, they moved their and didn't find what they thought was good evidence of the barracks. They moved over to the southwestern or southeastern eastern side of Route 9 and examined the area that's south of Snook Road and north of Van Wyck Lake Road. And this area, which is, you can see here, the Erskine plan shows has a stable on it. There's a little square. The text says stable. They began to do work in this area in 1972. Now this area at the time had mid-20th century houses in it, some fallow fields and some woods, and they excavated two very narrow trenches. Long trenches, but narrow ones, by hand, through the woods, and did a series of test pits at intervals through the woods. And they identified some structural evidence. And they didn't dig a really big open area, so they weren't quite sure what they had. So they came back in 73 to expand on the excavations they did in 72. And this map shows their testing plan from 73. And you can see this is north, so Route 9's over here. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the property. There are some barn ruins and some building ruins out there. They dug some long trenches and did big blocks of excavation units in the area to try to figure out what the stone features were that they were finding in 1972. And here's a shot from 73 where they, you know, you can see they've done much larger excavations. I actually think this narrow trench here is a trench from the 72 excavations, and that's where they hit it. And then they expanded it, and you can see it's a fairly substantial amount of stone in the ground. And all told, they identified a series of stone features that I've added the red dashed line on, roughly outline a 30 by 45 foot building. And this is all north of Rachey Run. They also found a significant number of 18th century artifacts and a couple of pit features. So when I say pit features, archaeologically, they show up as a sort of a circular stain in the ground. And we dig the darker soil out of the lighter subsoil. And it gives us kind of a pit shape. Sometimes it's basin shaped. Sometimes it's more round shape. They found these pit features, and they also had a significant amounts of 18th century material in them. And here's just some of the items that they found. I put these two slides up. I'm sorry I don't have better shots of their reports. I put these two shots up because they show some very definitively Revolutionary War-related materials. You can't see it, but I believe this is a pewter button with USA intertwined on it. And this is a sort of a Continental Army jacket button that would have been directly associated with soldiers in the Revolutionary War. This is a 6-pound cannonball that was found on site. This is a piece of grape shot. These are musket flints. I think this one is actually, you'll have to trust me on this, a honey-colored brown, which means it's probably a French musket flint. And I think one or two of these are 60 caliber musket balls. So these are Revolutionary War period artifacts that they found in association with that stone feature and or in the pits on the site. Okay, now, not a lot happened after 73. They left the site and they finished writing up their report, which they issued in 74. But it's not until, I believe, 1996 that people go back to the site. And at that point, it was a company called Cityscape that came and did an examination of the same property. And this property is the property between Snook Road, Van Wyck Lake Road, and it extends up the creek here a little bit. And this property was slated for development, and Cityscape came and dug a series of test pits. And again, it's these gridded every 50 or 25 feet, or some places 15 meters, 30 meters, they would dig a test pit, and they dig it in this area here, these purple ones, for the, what I think is now a speedway station, is that?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. And they did that, and when they did that study, they found no revolutionary 18th century artifacts. They found prehistoric artifacts, more Native American artifacts, but they didn't find anything associated with the Revolutionary War. Very soon after that, in 1997, another company was brought in to look at the remaining undeveloped portions of the property, Greenhouse Consultants. And they did a shovel testing grid across the whole property, I believe at 50-foot intervals. And they began testing, and they didn't find anything at first. They came back and did some more trenching at the request of the New York State Museum. And they found two, in this trench here, they found two very large features. I think they were something like 13 feet by 8 feet. And some of those had animal bones in them. They had lots of brick in them. And they had 18th century materials in them. I think including another one of those USA pewter buttons. And they did work up until about 2000. And this sort of shows their work up to 2000. It shows the Temple University excavations. This is from their last report. And again, the property sat and was not developed any further. And in 2007, Greenhouse Consultants returned to the property and conducted an archaeological assessment of the property again that summarized all the previous excavations. And they proposed additional testing. So in 2007, Greenhouse Consulting did additional trenching on the property. And these dark trenches, again, here's Route 9, Van Wyck Lake Road, Snook Road. This is Rachy Run here, which is used to go straight across, but is now moved. And they did these excavations. And their main point, they wanted to re-identify and sort of assess the features that were identified by Temple University in the 70s. And this is what their trenches look like. You can see them all across Route 9. And here's some of the features that they re-identified. And I believe this is one of the segments of that large foundation that I showed you before. So they were able to re-identify the Temple University excavations, but they just opened windows into them again. And they did identify more 18th century and 19th century historic material associated with these features. Now, as part of this work, they looked to the south of Rachy Run. And this is a blurry picture, of Van Wyck Lake Road. And this is the DAR monument that now is in front of the Van Wyck House that marks the cemetery. And this is in its original place. And this is the field before it was overgrown. It was just a sort of a low meadow. And they started doing some testing in there in 2007, trenching. And they identified some soil stains. And I have this one pointed out for you, because these are the sort of things that are obvious to archaeologists, but might not be exactly obvious to everyone else. What I'm talking about is this rectangular soil stain here. And they found, I think, a few other of these. And so they excavated them. And they determined that they were grave shafts. And one of them even had human remains in it. So in all, they identified 8 grave shafts south of Rachy Run. And their recommendations were for preservation of the cemetery and for additional work to be done on the property north of Rachy Run, where they had re-identified the Temple University feature, which was probably people are interpreting as the stable remains. But that's a subject of debate. Because they had identified these graves, more additional work was done. In 2008, a company, John Milner Associates, was brought in to do ground-penetrating radar survey. So they did radar of the property, and Harkin Archeological Associates did a series of trenches after this GPR was done to determine the extent of the cemetery. John Milner Associates said that the cemetery was an area of about 0.4 of an acre. Said there were many anomalies that could be grave shafts, or were similar to the grave shafts that had been identified. And they delineated an area, and Harkin delineated an area, by excavating trenches and not finding anything. And, you know, they very thoroughly dug and sort of tried to develop a good boundary for the cemetery. They extended the trenches out from the boundary to ensure they weren't just missing, they weren't just in a gap. And they extended trenches into the cemetery. And in one of the trenches that they extended into the bounds of the cemetery, they did find additional human remains. These are two, I believe they're femurs that came out of the trench wall. Okay, now there's also been secondhand sources have said that remains have been found to the south of Van Wyck Lake Road and to the west of Route 9, but we can't substantiate these sources, and so it is possible that the military cemetery that was identified extends beyond the limits of that corner of the property. Okay. I think I'm just going to end with this slide. This shows the boundaries of the Fishkill Supply Depot, the Fishkill Supply Depot site, in blue, and our take on the areas of archaeological sensitivity that remain within those boundaries. A lot of the area under the mall, I think, is no longer has very little potential. The area underneath the 84 exit ramp, and then on the eastern side of Route 9, a lot of the occupation was concentrated close to the road, and we think that's where the real archaeology is going to be left over. And we've excluded the area of the Speedway site. With that, that's the end of the archaeological summary.
Okay, we'll have just a brief 15-minute break, and then we'll have the final session, which will discuss preservation possibilities and offer the chance for question and answer.
I am going to say a few words, suggestions, recommendations for future historical research. Jim is going to then say a few words, similar lines on future archaeological research. I'm going to come back and say a few words about resource management, archaeological resource management, and interpretive possibilities. I stress these are suggestions. These are ideas for you to think about. You may react violently against them. I don't know. You may think they're great suggestions. Then when I've done that, we're going to get Lance up, and we're going to sit him in between the two of us over there, and you're going to ask us questions, if you want, or throw things, whatever you like. Okay, so let's start with the history. Okay. So I'm going to, because I want to read what's up there.
These in approximate order of descending importance in our view are some things that you might think about doing. Engage a proper military historian, somebody who is really qualified in that area, somebody like Colonel Jennings from the Park Service, possibly, but a military historian who could follow up, I think, on the little research that we've done, the lot of research that Judy Wolf and Marty Beister and other people have done, and really comprehensively identify and prioritize what all these primary archival materials are. And there's a lot of them, and I touched on a few, but somebody needs to come in and say, these are the ones you really, really want to focus on. And these are the ones that you perhaps should look at, but they're perhaps not so important. So the following, the recommendations below, I think are kind of our sense of where that's going to go. My sense is that a systematic study of the War Department records, particularly the records of the Quartermaster's Department and the Commissary Department, are really worth looking at systematically. It's a very big job, enormous job. The New York State Militia records up in the State Archives in Albany are also worth looking at. And there again is an immense body of material that I don't think anybody has, that I'm aware of, has systematically looked through. Then maybe you can do things that are more targeted in the way of research into correspondence, military orders, so regimental orders, and writings of senior American officers, the ones that we know had a connection to Fishkill. And there's a lot of interesting people there. McDougall, Heath, Putnam, there's lots of people. Then also, this will be more difficult, targeted research into the key supply officers who were here on the ground during the war. And I have a list of maybe a dozen people, I think, who were there. The two main ones are Hugh Hughes and Udney Hay, but there's a lot of other very important people, John Ruddock, John Fisher, and Judy, you can probably add other people in. There's several of them, and these are people who you could really home in on and try and find out more about what they were up to and whether they do have manuscript materials relating to them somewhere. So it's the supply officers. Then this is a very long shot, but you get to go to Europe. there's almost certainly things in the French archives, in the British archives, and in the Hessian archives. You need to speak, read German, read French, effectively, in addition to be able to look at manuscript materials, which can be hard to read whatever language you're looking at. But there's going to be material in there. That's probably a relatively long shot. It would be very time-consuming, but there's probably things that would come out of that. And then the suggestion, I think, is that you build a really comprehensive timeline. My thought about this was that this was something maybe the Historical Society could do. You do it online. You have somebody who is a comptroller who can, and people contribute to this, but somebody needs to sort of sort it and decide whether it's bogus information or really satisfactory historical data. But you could have a sort of growing historical timeline database that the community constructs online. It'd be fun to do, it'd be really neat. But, and I think, Judy, I think you have the beginnings of something like this, and we did something that you'll see in our report that is similar to this, but it could really involve the community and be a fun thing to do. So that was some suggestions there for where you might go next with the historical stuff that I was touching on in my talk. Now Jim gets to blow your minds with the archaeology.
Okay, so you've seen this figure before, and it shows our areas where we think there still is a good deal of archaeological sensitivity. These include the sites of the barracks, which we'll never give up hope that there's some evidence of the barracks out there. Stables, which we think there probably is evidence of. There's a storehouse that's on the Erskine maps that we haven't located archaeologically yet. The smith shops, soldiers' huts that are mentioned, and that might extend along Van Wyck Lake Road, that might be in the back areas behind the main areas. So there's a lot of stuff, a lot of potential things to find still within the National Register boundaries. But there's also a lot of potential archaeology, probably more, outside of the depot boundaries, in places like the village of Fishkill, at the houses of the artificers and the officers, and the in Fishkill Landing, where there are bound to have been storehouses and places for making the boat working at the Fishkill Landing. There's a series of mill sites that we're supplying the depot all up along the Fishkill Creek that we've mapped out roughly on our maps. And these, all these mills, you know, these are 18th century mill sites that were, they were doing stuff for the Continental Army. Were they regular mills that were just giving their normal product over? Were they adapted for the Army use? There's Brinkerhoff's, there's all these existing 18th century buildings that had leaders, had knocks in them, had the Brinkerhoff house, places like that. So the churches that are still, that served as hospitals, and there's a prison out there somewhere, which we hear about in the records a lot, and we're not sure. It was a stockaded prison in one description. So there is a lot of archaeological sensitivity that extends beyond the depot site into the whole sort of Fishkill area. Okay, so we've also come up with the bulleted list of archaeological recommendations, and I'm going to do
what Richard did and step away from the podium. One of the first things we think needs to be done is an inventory that collects all the known artifact collections from all these excavations. The field documentation, a lot of artifacts, archaeologists can take a lot of notes, stacks and stacks of paper, they take a lot of photographs, and there's so many studies that have been done, it would be great to kind of get control over where the remains of all these studies exist. We know some are going to be in the Van Wyck House, some might be at the State Museum, or the New York State Museum, some might be at Temple University. I think we need to contact them and see if there's anything left over from those studies. And once you get all that stuff compiled together, it'll give you, maybe there's some unexamined material that we can learn something from. To the fullest extent possible, artifact collections, documentation, should be organized and consolidated at a single location. So building on the first recommendation, we think everything should be brought together in a secure, climate-controlled location that's accessible to researchers. So a place where people can come in and find that box that they know, they suspect this one unit is near the stables. Let's give me the artifacts from those units. And you can only really do that if you get control over it and have it in a good, stable, organized location. There is a potential, as I said, for more analysis of the studies that have been done already. And I'm not talking about the recent studies, I'm really talking about studies from the 70s, things that were done in the 60s by the Fishkill Historical Society, a lot of the stuff that was done from 75 to 86 that Carver reports. There's probably a lot of data there that can be fully interpreted and analyzed and can contribute to a really comprehensive sort of synthesis of the archaeology of the depot. And then we recommend that, as regulated land development and funding opportunities allow, future field investigations should be undertaken within the sensitivity zone, but only in the context of an appropriate research design with clear, justifiable research goals. We shouldn't just go out there and dig because everybody likes to dig or it's popular to dig. We should go out there and dig with intent, as I say, a research design that's laid out beforehand. So we're not just digging for the sake of digging for treasure hunting. We're digging because we need to find something out. We need to look at an area that might be developed, and that's one of the big recommendations. So it's there.
All right, I'm going to very delicately sort of enter this area of land use and resource management. And this is a particularly tricky area. It's not in many ways for us to say what you should do here. It's for you as a community to figure it out yourselves. But here's some things that strike us immediately, and they get more complex as you go. The first thing, so you have a National Register designated site out there that was designated in the 70s, I think the mid-70s, if I remember correctly, where that weird blue line that we've been looking at on all of these maps comes from. That is needs to be revisited. I mean, the boundary of the depot site is not adequately represented by that line. It needs to be reconsidered, and it should be reconsidered excluding what the current land use is within this entity. It should be a historically derived boundary. So it's going to include a large piece of the Duchess Mall. But if you want a boundary that reflects what the depot was, that's what you should be looking at. We also think that you could consider doing what they call a thematic National Register nomination, which is combining the depot site with other Revolutionary War sites in the Fishkill area within that larger area that we were showing on the maps, by the dashed line there, and link them all together. And the linking mechanism is the military supply activity. That's what you would connect them all with. So you could do that. These are complicated things to do, though, and you don't just do it in a few months. It would take several years to create certainly a thematic National Register nomination, a revision of the existing nomination. Second recommendation here is that state and federal historic preservation laws and regulations are adhered to with any future land development within the depot site. It's a very simple statement here that you should be abiding by historic preservation law at the state level and the federal level. And it's hard to know when that may apply, but it may well do in some instances. Again, this is getting progressively less. You may not want to hear this kind of stuff. You as a community should consider adopting historic preservation and archaeological provisions into the Fishkill Town Code. It's a suggestion. I don't know whether you're talking about it amongst yourselves right now, but it's certainly something that you can look to other communities in New York State. You can look outside of the state. There are many municipalities that have historic preservation regulations. They have historic preservation commissions or advisory boards. You know, there's lots of different ways you can pursue this, but it is something that you could think about doing that would help you protect and promote the Revolutionary War history that is so great that you have here. And then again, as a community, cooperatively plan for a balance of historic preservation and land use development within and immediately around the Fishkill Supply Depot site. And finding a balance that respects the role of the depot in the Revolutionary War. Some of you may feel like you already have that balance. I'm not going to tell you that you do or you don't. This relates specifically to the Van Wyck homestead. I'm sorry we've been mispronouncing that. We have Van Wycks in all over New Jersey, but you have Van Wycks in New York. I'll have to remember that one. And again, I'm not that familiar with the Historical Society and what they have done, what they have planned for the future, but that is an incredibly important building. And if a formal preservation plan and historic interpretive plan does not exist for that property, one probably should be created that aims to safeguard and promote the property's historic architectural and archaeological resources. Maybe in the questions some people can speak to that. And the last one, this is probably the most loaded one, is investigate the feasibility of public acquisition of privately owned land within the Fishkill Supply Depot, specifically on the east side of Route 9, for the purposes of preservation and education. And that may generate some comment also. So those are some, again, it says recommendations, they're suggestions for you all. We got suggestions here. I must have been wondering whether, are we making recommendations or suggestions? So final thing here is there's an awful a lot of opportunity for interpreting the Revolutionary War here in the Fishkill Valley at those three core locations, and at all of these other sites that are all up and down the valley and on the hills surrounding. There's lots of great sites. So we're not just focused on the depot site here, but we're focused on that larger area. So look for community, political, and funding support for heritage tourism development. That's what this is. I mean, to get people to come visit these sites, it's bringing people into your community. They will spend money. They will help your local economy. You have the basis for this here. You have some wonderful sites. You need to string them all together and interpret them in a way that will attract visitors. Establish an integrated historic interpretive program that links the many historic and archaeological sites in the Fishkill area. Okay, I've basically said that. Focus not just on the Fishkill Supply Depot site, but on the village, the landing, these other sites, and the landscapes and the vistas. I think that's tremendously important. As we drove up from New Jersey this morning, we came up the thruway, we come over that bridge, and you look ahead, and you see these mountains. You know, you see that breakneck ridge line of hills there. That is a wonderful element in this interpretation, both to look at from down in the valley and to go up there to where the beacon was and look out south towards New York. That's, you know, what they were defending, or looking back the other way into the valley. This is what we're protecting, the supply area there. So the landscapes and vistas are important in developing this interpretive plan. And then at the bottom there, these are just fairly standard things that one thinks about when you're looking at interpreting historic sites. Obviously, signage. And I think in this case, you're looking at a signage program, something that is really carefully put together, that has common design themes so that everybody knows that it all relates to Fishkill and military supply. I think there's an opportunity certainly for trails, low impact trails, linking some of these sites. When it comes to buildings, there's obviously opportunities for rehabilitating and restoring old buildings, Revolutionary War period buildings, landscaping issues, and then in your local visitor centers, making sure that the Revolutionary War history is really played up in these tourist information centers or information, visitor center. Is there a visitor center in the village? No? Okay. Okay. That's a good point to bring Lance in there. So, some suggestions there for you, and we're happy to engage you in whatever way you want to be engaged, and if we can't handle it, Lance will help.
So we have a lot of work to do, huh, based on those slides? I can tell you this, is that one of the very first things that was posed to me after I took over as president of the Friends Group was, what is the federal level, the national interest in this site that you are calling a site of national importance? And back in 2010, there was very little national interest in Fishkill. Today you have proof that there's national interest in our town, in this community, in this site. The American Battlefield Protection Program grant is really intended, was and is really intended for battlefield sites along the lines of a Saratoga or a Monmouth. When Bill Sandy and I went for our seminar and got trained by the Park Service, the head of the Battlefield Protection Program, Kristen McMasters, pulled us aside in a sidebar and said, the National Park Service is looking at Fishkill, and your site was selected for this grant despite not having a real battle being fought there, but because of its significance. And so for me, that was proof positive that there's federal level interest in our town. For those of you who participated in September's Revolutionary War weekend, especially the ceremony on Saturday, you saw that there's a second layer of federal interest in Fishkill. Janet Burnett is here. Janet, where are you? Okay, she's involved with the Washington Rochambeau Revolutionary Route Trail. They call it the W3R. It commemorates the American and French route of march in relation to and from the Battle of Yorktown. Fishkill, as I explained on that Saturday during our Revolutionary War event, Fishkill is not a site that is on the trail. We really are not on the route of march. But because the supply depot and its function and its feeding of the men and feeding of the forces and the supplying of the forces in the field was so important, the Washington Rochambeau Trail, again a National Park Service entity, took the exceptional step of naming the Van Wyck Homestead and the Fishkill Supply Depot site to the Washington Rochambeau Trail, even though it's probably 30 miles from the actual trail. Okay? So there's two levels of interest. It's taken 5 years, but we're there. I'm anxious to see what the next 5 years hold. So now we will take questions, please. Start here. Ladies first, Marty.
Sorry, Marty. Hi, my name's Teresa. I don't even know where to start. Thank you.
Just speak loudly.
Okay, we don't have time to reflect. And we don't have years to act. Hunter research, I don't want to use that.
Go ahead.
From your experience and knowledge, what would you recommend? How can we get the county, the town, and the village elected officials from allowing these historic hollow grounds from being blacktopped and developed, especially if these grounds are located within the National Register boundaries? Fishkill in this area has enough signs saying, here stood, here was, this was. Last year we lost the Jackson House, was a historic tavern. Within the boundaries, they said that they would put a replica there. They're going to put a sign.
And it was on people the National Register.
Yes, people don't want to come and visit a sign. Are you researching the local taverns, the blacksmith shops? Lance mentioned the people that made the food, the bread. These were all without the, in the boundaries that you said, that is not just right down by 84, that are connected. And what about the homes that are 17th, 18th century? That housed the 7,000 units of people that were here supporting these people at the Fishkill Supply Depot. We need help real fast because they're ready to bulldoze the whole thing and put up a faux replica of here stood, here's a building that looks like something you could visit. Whatever we can do, however I can help, I'm there.
Well, I'll take that one. For starters, I mean, my experience shows that, the blueprint is community involvement. It's not one person. It's not a team of five people. It's a combination of raising awareness both locally and in the region and certainly at the federal level. But also, it takes volunteers, it takes manpower. You know, our group operates under the philosophy that the more people who know about the history of Fishkill, the less they would stand for any development on the site. And that's what we believe and that's what we're striving to do. Inform people, educate people, position ourselves. Our group is trying to position itself as the one-stop shop for all information relating to Fishkill Supply Depot. So that when somebody new stumbles on it on the internet and calls us, we can tell them what it's about and we can tell them what the dangers are and what's afoot. It's a long process, it's a marathon for certain.
Marty?
Yes, the piece of property that's defined in the National Register is now proposed for development. And some of the work that you mentioned, the archaeological work that you mentioned, was done by Cartwright, and a report was submitted in 1974. And then subsequently there was a study, 2007-2009 is what the developer calls it on his submittal before the planning board, that supposedly went back, that report investigated whether what was found by Cartwright was still there and viable. And what I'm
thought would come out here is what is there? What is in that 2009 report that we should know about, and what should be preserved? There you pointed out that there were storehouses, there were barracks possibly there, I believe on one of the slides, and also stables. And yet, I've heard nothing about the 2009 report and what they found. I think they, in their management summary, it says there are active and legitimate findings that need to be further investigated. And I'd like to know your response to which ones those are.
Okay, I'm gonna try this without the microphone. I believe the 2009 study by Greenhouse Consultants recommends the preservation of the area south of Rachey Run, the military cemetery area. And they also recommend more work or more investigation of the area north of Rachey Run. And that's, it's a somewhat, it's not a very specific recommendation. They did re-identify the Temple University excavations. They had also done some work north of where Temple University dug. But all of these excavations over the last, 30, 40 years have just kept on, they've taken slices out of the site. And then a Greenhouse in 2007 took another slice and re-identified a slice that had already been taken. It did a little more than that. But they, no one's come in and done a sort of a holistic investigation or a whole study, done large area excavations to figure out, to help really interpret what these features are. And for instance, the Greenhouse study, I believe they say that they think it's the stables or the remains of the stables. But you know, when you only have a little piece of it, you know, you saw how segmented those excavations were. You don't really know, is it, you need a little more information. So in archaeology, we normally work on a sort of a three-stage level. We do a background research and identification stage, which we call stage one. We just go out and figure out if something's there or not. Then at the phase two level, we go in and we assess the significance and the potential and the integrity of a site. And then if you can't avoid the site, you go to the phase three level, which is the mitigation, or the what's often called an archaeological data recovery, where you come up with a research design and say, this is what we think is out there from the phase two work. This is what we think we can has to be done to fully recover all the information on site. And that's a phase three. I think they've done the sort of phase two work, but they've not done the sort of phase three work. The work that would really, really fully identify and define what's out there. So we can make guesses. I mean, and I think the best guess at the moment is that we're looking at remnants of the stable, but we're not 100% sure because of the limited the sort of slices that we can look at.
And just so everybody's clear, the nature of this project did not call for hunter research to go on the land and actually conduct its own archaeology. They simply were gathering all the known and existing past reports and trying to synthesize the information that had already been learned. Follow up.
Yes, I understand what was said. That what would Friends of Fishkill Supply Depot do next?
Well,
I mean, to save the site, it sounds to me what from the answer I got that there is a need to do additional archaeological work on site. How do we get that done? It sounds to me like the planning board here in the town is may be unaware of what work needs to be done because those reports have not been submitted by the developer so far.
They don't care.
So what do we do next?
Well, the town planning process, Marty, calls for at a certain interval for public comment, okay? The attempts that our group has made so far to provide information to the planning board, they haven't been fully received because now is not the proper time. When the planning board opens itself up to public comment, all the available information that we have, and I hope the Fishkill Historical Society has, should and ought to be presented to the town board so that it has the tools necessary to decide whether for the future betterment of the town, development should occur or not. So we're working within the town process. Yes, ma'am.
I have a question. You mentioned adherence to state and federal laws in regard to National Register properties. What are those laws? How are there? Is there anything that is really restrictive or that has to be followed? Because it doesn't seem like there has been in the past.
A National Register listed property that is privately owned, the landowner has the right to do with that property as he or she so chooses. So it gives you protection from public projects, publicly funded or publicly permitted projects. And I think, as Lance has said, it was really not within our scope to focus on a particular development project. I don't know if there are state permitting requirements related to projects that are within the depot. You know, that may then involve the State Historic Preservation Office, which then gives you another level of scrutiny above the municipal level. I'm not familiar with the, you know, with the project you're talking about.
Steve? Can you define what a cultural resource is? And is Fishkill Supply Depot a cultural resource?
Cultural resource is a really confusing term. I do not particularly subscribe to it myself. To some people it means a theater or an art gallery. Within the world in which we work, a cultural resource, and the discipline is cultural resource management. We call ourselves consultants in cultural, working in cultural resource management. Cultural resources are usually historic architectural properties, archaeological resources, archaeological properties, historic landscapes. So those are the three sort of main types of resource that come under that term, cultural resource. Is that helpful?
Is this site one?
Oh, is this site, yes, this site is absolutely a cultural resource, yeah.
Because
it has a historic architectural resource in the Van Wyck homestead and documented archaeological resources within its limits.
That are part of our shared history.
Far back. Yep.
The area of Fishkill here that we're talking about is also part of another federally designated conservation area, which would be of use. This is the Fourth State Highlands Conservation Area, which was established by Congress in 2004 by the Highlands Conservation Act. And you can find a lot about it online to figure out how it could be useful, but in brief, the purposes of the Act are to recognize the importance of the water, forest, agricultural, wildlife, recreation, and cultural resources of the Highlands region and the national significance of the Highlands region to the United States. It's funded through Congress. We've never gotten as much funding as we were allowed under the Act, but we have been funded for up to $10 million per year for purposes of education and land and site acquisition. But to me, part of the significance of that is that I don't think anybody could correct me, but I think there are not that many places, at least on the eastern seaboard that I know of, which are encompassed or by three federally designated areas, which also carry funding and designation and protection. Here in Fishkill and in other places, I live in Rockland. We're in the same three designation areas. We're part of the Hudson River National Heritage Area. We're part of the Forest State Highlands Conservation Area. And now we have also the Washington-Rochambeau route going through, which also recognizes the importance of Fishkill and the Supply Depot here. So three federally designated honors or distinctions, if you want to call it, all of which carry some level of protection or funding. And if you're applying to other grants to mention those things, that carries a lot of weight too. And just briefly, I just wondered, it occurred to me, I mean, I'm just somebody who loves models. I love architectural renderings. And I know some people are very visual, some people are very tactile, and they like to see things in three dimensions, or at least to imagine something in three dimensions by looking at a rendering. Has anybody made a model of the whole conservation, I mean, the whole depot area as we understand it might have existed from the studies you talked about?
Not the entire thing. There have been models of made of like the soldiers' barracks, but not in its entirety to where it could be used to educate the public.
It might be really compelling to have one, say, at a public site like the Historical Society or whatever, where people can visit it and see and, you know, kind of inspired by what was and what might be.
Barbara?
Well, it seems to me that, of course, it's very important for the town of Fishkill, but this is also major county history and, thank goodness, now federal history. If it wasn't for the last Congress that finally recognized the existence of the Revolutionary War, which they had never done before, and it was very difficult to try to get them to acknowledge the existence because we weren't a country then. So here our country was trying to, anything to do with civil war, they throw money at you. But they didn't even acknowledge the existence of the Revolutionary War, and the Friends of the Fishkill Supply Depot certainly had a lot to do with getting that recognition that this war existed. And here on this site is where America's first patriots are buried. And I didn't hear once the fact that there's hospitals on the site, one if not more on this site. So we're talking about not just eight bodies and actual femurs that were buried in this very interesting soil that preserved them, but we're talking about a lot more. And people that existed, and we have the background thanks to the Friends of the Fishkill Supply Depot board and the research people, of not only where they are, but who they are, and who their relatives are, and people that contact all the time and say, that's my great-great-grandfather. So it's not just, you know, a field where some bodies were. These were our first patriots. And to me, the fact that the National Park Service is not only recognizing, but sees it as an important part that we all know, even in Connecticut, this is a major route. This is part of our history, a very important part of our history that we should really be securing. And if not for raising funds, and what about eminent domain? What about whatever? This is well beyond, and I'll wrap it up, but this is beyond us. So beyond us and in our lives. If we all left money in our wills to preserve this, it is too late. It's too late, but this is beyond a logo, beyond us sitting here in the room, and beyond people like me who would hold placards saying, don't bulldoze. This is more important. This is worth standing up for and fighting for. Thank you.
I don't know if there's anybody else in this room, but I have an ancestor that's buried there in that ground. He was a French-Canadian, and he served with the American forces, and he's buried on that ground, and it's sacred, hallowed ground, and it should be preserved, because there are other people in this nation, as far as California, that have written to me about their ancestors that served here. And it's an important historical place that should be preserved. and Fishkill will be put on the map. Not just the historical maps, but on the current maps.
All right.
And besides the history, there are also endangered species that live in that area. For years, we saw a fisher that would run across the road and go into a culvert that's on that property, and it should be preserved because fishers, if you will note on any natural history site, you will see that the fishers are no longer as prevalent as they were. And I think besides the history, it's also an environmental habitat that should be preserved. Thank you.
Hi. I'm just going to make an idea here. I know that Van Wyck Middle School is celebrating its 50-year anniversary. And I know, and I applaud all of you who have been working and volunteering for the Supply Depot, but how do we get to the community, Lance, like you're talking about? There's tremendous emotion in this room. How do we think about getting it out there to people who are just ignorant? You know, and I'm a believer in the next generation. I think the next generation needs to get involved in this fight. I know that the schools, the local schools, don't teach any of the local history. That's so rich and abundant here. It just blows my mind. And we're giving the kids a disservice here. If we let them and connect them to this rich historical culture that we have beneath our feet, I think we could start raising that community, Lance, that you're talking about that we need. And instead of, you know, get away from the emotion, let's get with the facts. I think the model is an outstanding idea.
Yeah.
Outstanding. And start bringing them into this. You know, I talk to my sons and they say, Mom, when you talk about the history, we don't even know about it. You know, and they're college students. College, you know, they graduated from SUNY schools. So let's bring Governor Cuomo into this. I mean, I don't know if you have, probably. But, or just start at the ground level, like you said before. Let's start at the schools. Van Wyck, her husband is the principal of Van Wyck. And they're doing a special celebration for the 50-year anniversary this Christmas, right? It'd be a wonderful thing just to talk about. Get 15 minutes on the agenda, do it as a story, you know, to the kids, light their imaginations, the parents, get them involved. It starts that way. So that's my two cents.
You sound like you just volunteered.
Well, I have an in with the principal.
She brought up a very good point of getting the young youth and children involved in this. My American Legion folks, we've been going to John Jay High School, and at the principal's request and, you know, authority, we go to their study halls and we make presentations on the United States and on the Legion and the veterans. Maybe the same thing could be done with the Fishkill, Van Wyck, and the Supply Depot homesteads. Start going to get Bonnie King as the principal there. Get in touch with her and maybe come in on your study halls, get people who would volunteer to go and do that and give them information on this and get these young kids involved.
Well, very good idea. Frank.
I've said it in the past, and you know, and we've done it, to say what people are saying right now. The kids are the ones, I mean, to stop what's going on right this second, it's not helping, but to get them involved, the kids are the ones that we need to get involved. You know, and everybody else in the Supply, you know, friends group know, I'm a local scoutmaster. Marty came to our troop 5 years ago and did a presentation for our boys. And after he left, and you know, we were explaining, Mara was in charge at the time, and they were explaining about the cemetery and what was going on, and all the boys just kept looking, going, we don't understand. Why would anybody be looking to build or develop, you know, where there's a cemetery, where there's all this history? You know, and you had to explain to the kids, it's their ideas, their thoughts are still, to be more simple, more pure than adults are. You know, a lot of adults understand, they know what should be done, but greed and money and whatever else plays in, you know, affects them. But the kids are definitely the way, you know, the way to the future to come up with some of the ideas, to implement some of the ideas that were brought up here today. It is a youth program. It's to teach these kids, you know, inform them. Because they're the ones 5 years from now, 6 years from now, 10 years from now, they're going to be the ones that are, you know, helping make decisions.
One of the products we did, we haven't shown anybody yet, is the booklet, which condenses the historical research into 8 pages. Well, 12 pages, sorry. That's 2 covers, though. That's 10 pages of text. That condenses a lot of the historical research and makes the history of Fishkill Depot a little bit more accessible. So that's a product that will come out of this study eventually.
Just a quick thing, will you make your PowerPoint available online for us?
That's a question we have not thought about.
it's a public product.
Yeah, I would yeah. Answer.
Okay.
Yeah, everything's going to be publicly available at one point or another.
Oh, okay.
Don't it's make all, it's all, well, it's funny, listen, it's funded with taxpayer
dollars.
Don't
make us wait too long.
Yes.
The historical research has been very important. Has there been any legal research on how these lands that have fallen into municipal or private hands have, you know, when you buy a house, there's a cloud on a title, there's all kinds of legal research that has to be done in terms of how a property gets handed down. So what is the legal research, if any, on how this property ended up in this situation? Is there any knowledge on that?
Well, that's a fantastic question. You have to keep in mind that, especially now in the wake of what you've learned here today, that the original Supply Depot site, let's just talk about the core area, right? So the area close to Interstate 84 and Route 9 is now a jigsaw puzzle worth of a number of properties, okay? There's a one map in the back there that depicts the different landowners. To answer your question more directly, there has not been a systematic and professional legal analysis of the different properties and or the sorts of things that would need to be overcome or addressed before development occurred. Okay, there's been some journeyman work on the part of our group, but nothing professionally done.
Just to follow up to that, there is. I know again when you purchase a house, there's these insurance policies that you buy in case you know your property ends up being a Indian burial ground or something you weren't aware of. We just
right.
purchased the historical home and we had to buy that insurance. So you know, I'm wondering if some kind of legal study that might look into some of those things, that maybe that insurance money or somehow you know there would be some way to get insurance companies to purchase some of this property back and give it to the Supply Depot or how that would work legally. I'm not a lawyer, but I just kind of wonder about that.
It sounds like something that should be looked into. The particular properties within that core location, we have not done title searching on, but I mean my suspicion is you'll be able to track the titles back pretty clearly into the Revolutionary War period. I'm not aware, Judy, I don't know whether you can help
me. No,
you.
I can't.
You can't? Okay.
Yeah, a friend of mine who does do title searches did go back on the property that we're all discussing. And I think because it was so well known by people for so long that there was a burial ground there, it was never put in a deed. And I think that answers your question.
It was never put into the deed.
It's not. There's nowhere in any of the deeds going back in the chain of title saying that there was a burial ground there.
So what does that mean legally? Like,
well, because if you have title insurance, that's not going to make any difference. Because I myself, because of a taking of my front lawn, did have to the title insurance. So that doesn't come in question in this. And I think it was that going back into the 1800s, everyone knew that that was a burial ground. So it was never put in to the deed for that property.
So how does someone get to sell that then? How do they sell that particular part of that land?
That I don't know.
It has to get into private hands from this burial ground.
Well, it was originally the Van White Homestead property. That's where it started as. And it was the burial ground, and I think it was just accepted as common knowledge that that's where the soldiers were.
But then it was sold off.
Right. But when that moved, I'm sure, then that, it just left people's...
That's where your problem is, when it got sold off. How did it get sold off? And what is that legally?
Do you have the...
I have the list. I have all those deeds, yes, I can.
Lynn?
That could be part of our finding.
Some years ago, my history partner and I, Roy Jorgensen and I, started a group called the Mid-Hudson Historic Destinations. And our most recent publication, and we now have a website, we published 30,000 of these brochures. And the Supply Depot is one of our members, Washington's headquarters, the Newburgh Historical Society. We've got Putnam, Orange, Dutchess, and Ulster County members. 32 small house museums, a consortium, in these wonderful, rich, historic areas of the Mid-Hudson Valley region. And we have now six more people who are clamoring to join and want to get to us to print another 30,000 with them, and it would bring us up to 30-something. And we have a website, midhudsonhistoricdestinations.org, and it has a newsletter, and it has historic comments and photographs of all of the sites, which include Museum Village, which includes, you name it, Locust Grove. I mean, there's just wonderful participants in everything that has to do with history, landscape, historic landscape, which is so, this is the origins of the historic artistic architectural landscape movement, happened here, and with A.J. Downing in Newburgh, and Edith Sunnyside in Poughkeepsie, which is his last existing landscape. Anyway, this is what we're about. And it has a huge educational component, as you were talking about. And we run programs for students all the time. In fact, I have 60 students coming to, on the 7th of November, 60 high school students coming to meet me at the Crawford House for an architectural historic event, which I'm leading. Anyway, that's what I do, and it's all volunteer. And Roy and I are...
In fairness to the folks who want to talk about Fishkill, can you wrap it up?
Yes, and Fishkill is a big, big part of it. Thank you.
Thank you. In the back.
You mentioned in the archaeological recommendations that any digging should be really targeted and focused, but is there a hierarchy of spots that you think should be dug and excavated first? Specific spots on the property or in the area?
Well, the whole area of archaeological sensitivity that you define is going to have something in it. And, you know, and while a lot of it's been investigated already, it probably needs more investigation. But I wouldn't do it just, you know, for the sake of digging, I guess is the point. Is only do it, you know, an archaeologist is our first thing we want to do is conserve a site. You know, we find a site, we identify it. If there's no development pressure, it should just be conserved and remain in place. No digging just for the sake of digging. If you just have to have a good reason to go dig. So the targets would probably be more based on plans or, you know, potential disturbance than they would actually on what you want to go out and hit. Let's say you, I guess that's probably all I'll say.
On the table. Right, we're going to take just a couple more questions.
Okay. In your findings, how far back off of Route 9, heading east, did you guys determine maybe that the digs have been done over the time?
Excavations? There were a range of studies from the Van Wyck House east between between Snook Road and 84. I've been saying Van Wyck for 9 months.
No, but I'm saying down by Van Wyck. Say down by Van Wyck Road.
Yeah.
Going east. Most of it is right at the road.
Most of it has not been studied along the road. Yes.
Okay.
Most of it's concentrated within the first. 400 feet maybe from the road back. That's where most of the investigations came about. So there's this sort of meadow up along the creek that hasn't been looked at. But But I think our interpretation of the archaeological sensitivity kind of takes into account that we think that the occupation was really right along the road, and that anything that happened during the Revolutionary War, sort of as you get further and further away from the road, is going to be less intense occupation and is going to leave less trace. And so that archaeological potential kind of goes down as you get farther away from the more intense periods, places of occupation.
But there were hundreds of men there, so they couldn't all just been covered over the road.
No.
They were spread out, so yeah. How could you say that?
I mean, there were 2,000 people across the road.
Right, so there's got to be so much artifacts of that mountain.
When they built these walls, they found grave and stone, stone markers and skeletons of revolutionary soldiers when they built the wall.
I think you're thinking of the area that's presently defined by the National Register of Historic Places. Their argument, which I and my group now believe, is that the Fishkill Supply Depot complex was much, much greater.
Right.
Stretch it from East Fishkill to the Fishkill Landing or Beacon. And so the concentration, let's say, of 1,000 or 2,000 troops would not have been along Route 9 south of 84, it would have been throughout that complex.
Yeah. And as far as the cemetery, the same thing. That has to be broader than that little space at the corner.
Yeah, well, I mean,
I went on that little walk with the developer, and he was talking to the planning board. Oh, here it is.
We agree. We think it's larger. Mm-hmm.
Make one more comment. First of all, is that the 1974 report by Julia Cartwright made at least three recommendations in the back. To me, from what I see, those recommendations were never addressed properly. One was a pile of what someone might call rubble and with slag on it that indicated there might have been some kind of iron manufactory there. There was also this feature number one, which was a corner of a perhaps the stables. There's also a platform of a pavement of some sort that could have been connected to another cobblestone pavement, I think you mentioned. That those three things in that report, as far as I know, were never reported or investigated as she recommended. Then, to take one step further, in 2007, the archaeological work that was done passed over at least feature one, and in the management summary of the 2009 report for that dig, in the last paragraph, it says that they recommend further archaeological work. And yet, that is not before the board, the planning board of the village. And the village has, rather the town, and the town has not yet decided that that is a type one requirement by CEQR, the State Environmental Quality Review Act. And I think that's very disappointing, and it's interesting too that the document that really should have action taken on, I believe, is that 2009 report. It should address Cartwright's recommendations, and it should carry forward whatever additional things they did. They list several what they call foundations. Whether it's the same one or not, I do not know.
The Cartwright study was done sort of out of regulatory context. It wasn't done because someone said you have to do this study. So that's why its recommendations were made to, that's why they weren't followed up on. There was no process to make them.
I think our planning board owes it to the town, the citizens, the state, and the county to get that report and follow through with the recommendations.
One of the things, I'm Jim Johnson, Hudson River Valley Institute. One of the things that we did at Fort Montgomery and was done at the Monmouth battlefield is the use of metal detecting. And I think that, for example, if you're still trying to figure out whether or not a stable was a stable, if you find horse-related stuff and metal detecting, you'll find iron, you'll find all those kinds of things. So I would recommend that the next stage that would not be nearly as invasive as the traditional pit technique would be to use metal detecting to maybe do your phase three, at least a way to get started. I know that you archaeologists have different opinions about metal detecting, but I think it's a valid
We've worked with metal detectors on sites, military sites. We've done the metal detecting work ourselves in very sort of rigid control grids. We've brought on avocational metal detectorist groups who signed up to our methods, and we've had some good success with them. And it's a valid way of doing survey work. We would not, absolutely not, encourage anyone else to go out there without the archaeological method, or just, hey, I'm going to go find the stable site and take a metal detector out there. And
well, there's one firm that is a not-for-profit that did the Monmouth.
Yep, yeah, and we've worked with them as well, and have had.
The best way to control it is under, it's a state contract, basically.
Yeah.
The other thing that helped you, I think, just so everybody understands, this has been on the radar for a while, the report to Congress of American Revolutionary War of 1812 sites in 2007 put us on the list of the important American Revolutionary sites.
Yes.
So I think that must have helped probably with the grant.
Okay, we'll take one more question.
Maybe not.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Kenya Shuket. I'm not very comfortable speaking publicly. English is not my first language, so I apologize up front. I am the wife of the principal of Penn White. And I believe that my husband would be extremely interested in presenting the students with information about Fishkill. So if you would like to approach him, he will probably be able to direct you to the Board of Education. If you have a lesson plan for the students in the area, perhaps someone should approach the Board of Education and with the approval go to all schools in a schedule and show the students, teach the students about the area. I think that they would be very interested, my husband especially. As my profession is not in teaching, but I work in banking, so part of my job is to analyze investments. And when you analyze investments, you have to show and prove that there's an interest, that there will be money income coming from somewhere. So my suggestion, if I may humbly suggest, that perhaps you could contact Metro North. They always put pamphlets on the train showing public if there's an interest for a weekend getaway to areas. With that said, perhaps you could also create a modest nearby information center. I have been to Williamsburg, I have been to Jamestown, I have been to all the areas where my son, as he was going to school, was learning about. We have taken him there to learn. So perhaps a modest center with a model, which I think also is a great idea because it gives you a visual 3D somewhat. And also I do like the idea of the Fishkill Supply Depot putting together a tour. We bought many times when we were in Jamestown, we bought an audio tour. You just put in a DVD, it was a cassette. You just put in your car and you just drive to the area where there are sites for you to see. You pay for this, it's an income for the depot, and that seems what we need also, some income. You should have charged for today. I would gladly have paid. I really enjoyed myself. Thank you.
Remember, it's already paid for with taxpayer dollars. We're not permitted to take.
Oh, then I contributed already.
However, you might have a till in the back if you want to chip in.
Absolutely. I already picked up an envelope.
That was good.
Well, listen, I want to thank everybody for coming. I think it's obvious by the number of comments and questions that it's a relevant topic. It's one that's before our community now. At some point, all of the materials that these gentlemen have produced will be reviewed by the Battlefield Protection Program staff and will become a part of public record available, hopefully on our website. Okay. all except the very, very, very detailed archaeological map, because treasure maps are not permitted. But we'll be, we'll be around for a little bit afterwards if you want to talk to us privately. Otherwise, thank you for coming.